alternative test. Okay.
Definitely.
So if you want, we can start. So basically, thank you everybody for being with us. Huh? Okay. So I have invited test experts and students today to share their experience with us. And the objective of the seminar of today is what are the alternatives to the GMAT? Because as you know, the GMAT is often associated to top business school, which is of course true, but there are other ways around. Okay. And there are students who, because they don't have time, because they don't have the skills, whatever, or the patience, who cannot pass the GMAT. For instance, last Wednesday, I believe, we got the result for ESCP. And the four students that I got accepted to the ESCP MIM were students who could not pass the GMAT, okay? Because for many reasons, lack of time, lack of skills. And we decided to take the ESCP test called ESHL, okay? And we have finally passed it and been accepted to ESCP, okay? And they are very happy. Anyway, what else could be better than ESCP in terms of ranking? Maybe Sagalan, HEC, but basically it's not very different. So I'm here today, I will send you the presentation, so I'm a test expert. Nick Bernard, who is my friend, who is running GMAT Zurich, okay, and he has been in this industry for at least 15 years, and tell me if I'm wrong. He's also a professor at the University of St. Gallen, at the St. Gallen Hochschule, of St. Gallen, and he speaks many languages, and he's also teaching the GMAT at Frankfurt School of Finance and Management, which is a school that you are targeting, probably. And is it Tübingen or LMU that you're teaching? Huh?
LMU.
So what is good is that there's also an experience. And of course, since he runs a test prep center in Zurich called GMAT Zurich, he is also confronted to the same problem as well, the problem that we have. So students who fail and who ask for alternative tests. Anand, who is also running his test prep center he's a data scientist and was in addition probably to his job, a test prep center, and he's probably also knowledgeable about this.
Nice.
And finally, Anushka, who was my student, who got accepted to ESMT Vlerik and IE, and well, issues with the GMAT, and we have decided to apply to other schools using other tests. Of course, it was a nightmare. We had to prepare for each school, she had to prepare a test, but finally, these tests look alike somehow, okay? She will share experience with us. Are you with us, Anushka?
Yes, yeah. Sir. Yeah. Good evening, everyone.
Basically, the admission process, so good morning. So Nick, so I made a slide on this one, and probably that's something that you know very well. So what is the admission process to a business school? If you can give us a summary.
Are you talking to me, Hubert?
Yeah.
No. Well, I mean, we're looking, yeah, we have this, listen, and Hubert, you can back me up or disagree, but we work here with four different items. And one is the test itself, whether it's GMAT, GRE, other tests. The other is the essays. The other are your grades, your transcripts, and the other are the recommendations.
Yeah.
So we basically take these four things and we put them in order and we try and find strengths and weaknesses. Now, since we're here today to talk about the tests and the alternative to GMAT, let's skip right to that section to the GMAT.
So basically,
now, for a complicated variety of reasons, it doesn't happen for every person who takes the course. Let's just be honest about that. Same with you, Bird, right? And on the other hand, the schools have a problem because they see profiles that they want to accept, but the GMAT is either missing or at a lower range. So what we can do are two things, really. The first is to take an alternate test, and that is either the GRE or a school-specific test. And the second thing we can do is to just negotiate on a school-by-school basis. So
if it's possible.
Having to talk now on a general level, but this is, every student has a little different strength and weakness, a different profile. So this year, I can tell you what, with this whole COVID situation, we've been very successfully negotiating and just telling schools that it wasn't possible or it was too stressful or whatever. And then going to alternative routes.
You're lucky, huh? Because the problem that we have, what we have noticed also this year with the COVID, that we have noticed that also there are many more applicants, okay? Many. And they have so many applicants that they don't really care, okay? Because you see LBS, for instance, for the masters only, for the MIM, they had plus 50%. So when you have plus 50%, they say, I had students refuse at LBS with a 650. Mm-hmm. And before it did not happen. So maybe also, probably one of the advantage that you have over us is that you're based in Switzerland and they need three students probably, so you can negotiate, it's good. But of course, what I see, unique when you're French or Indian, there's no negotiation there. They don't care. I had a student refuse at ESSEC this year with a 700 Spanish guy, 700. Okay.
Didn't get so in.
No, he got interviews with HEC, nothing at ESSEC. Yeah. And he got finally EDEC and SMT. It's a bit of failure. So now we're going to apply to INSEAD. I hope that we get INSEAD. But he got accepted already. But in is my only failure this year, really, where the guy got a 7 year school. So basically, so as Nick explained, so normally there's a process that you all know that I've described here. You see in the video. But there are also other ways around. Okay, so the GMAT, you know what the GMAT is about. You see my screen, Nick? You all see my screen?
I do. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So basically, you all know what the GMAT is about.
Mm-hmm.
And how can I say? Well, you know, it's the star test, therefore section, etc. There's a score. And of course, the reason why the GMAT is often associated to top business schools because you have 7,000 programs, which means 2,000 plus business schools accepting the GMAT. Okay. The issue of the GMAT is, of course, last year, it was difficult to take it because the centers were closed, so they created a home-based GMAT thing. And what is the situation, for instance, in Switzerland? The assessment centers have reopened, or what is the situation for you?
It's normal, Hubert. To be honest, yeah. It's normal, so that we don't have an excuse anymore. And even if it weren't normal, all these tests you can do online now at home.
Yeah.
So we run out of the excuse we used to use that said it was not possible to go to the test center.
So, for instance, last year, I got two students accepted to HEC without GMAT, and HEC MIM. Huh? Okay.
Yeah.
And so HEC MBA, so for instance, last year, between April and May, you could get into HEC without the GMAT. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, and to tell you the truth, the two that I got accepted to HEC, they took their GMAT, but they got like 500. But because the application was strong, they got in. So it means that it's a funny story. So it means that they miss a lot of candidates taking the GMAT, and these guys have been so lucky. Yeah, can you imagine?
That's
by the way, from what I understand, they have difficulties finding internship because, of course, when you have an HEC candidate, you expect the guy to be strong, and they must be a bit disappointed probably when they meet them. But they got in without the GMAT, and HEC MBA up to October you could apply without the GMAT. So I had students between April to October who have been accepted without the GMAT, and I had so many accepted because, of course, it was so easy to get in. And then you see, Nick, what they realized that finally there would be more applicants, not fewer, there would be more, and now they are becoming more strict. Okay?
Yeah,
because people who work are sick of working at home, they want a different environment, and the young ones, they know that they will not get an internship or a job, so they want to keep studying.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically the way it goes. So basically, the first alternative to the GMAT is the GRE. Okay. So anyway, the GRE is pretty close to the GMAT. By the way, it was until 2001. It was the same company that was making the GMAT and the GRE, and then after that they split. Now, why would you recommend the GRE and Nick to someone versus the GMAT? Why?
Hubert, we talked a lot about this, you and I. I think we agree that it's probably a little bit easier, but it's not easier for everybody. So when I recommend it, it's to a person who's very good with English, who has lots of vocabulary, and maybe weaker in math and numbers. So that's one reason why. The other reason why is that it's just a different approach to the test, and it's maybe a personality might respond better to the look and feel of it, and that already gives an edge.
Yeah.
And then the third reason would be, what's the school you're applying to, and maybe the GRE is even preferred or seen as equal, and this is also a factor. So people applying to the humanities, for example,
We're talking of business school programs, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you asked why we do
that's
it.
That's basically so where our plan. Yeah. So basically, I would say I will agree with you. So I would say two things to consider. So first of all, the math part of the math section of the GRE is not very difficult. So if you're not good at math, for instance, I have a student now who is super good with, but he's not good at math. Mm-hmm. So I suggest that we switch from the GMAT to the GRE, and I have many in this situation. So what we do with them, we work on their GMAT, and then 2 or 3 months before they take the test, we switch to GRE. The GMAT is a good basis, for instance, for math. And then they go for the GRE. So basically, yeah. The other thing that you have to notice as well, people have to know, so easier in math, you have a calculator. And you see, Nick, some people cannot live with a calculator, so they need a calculator. Yep. They don't have a calculator on the GMAT. And also what they like about the GRE is that the GMAT is put into the statistics, okay? So there's only one ranking that uses the GMAT, it is US News and World Report, that uses the GMAT in its algorithm, if you want. But let's say in its ranking, okay, but the GRE is never used. So I have a funny story with a student.
Yes,
he has not been accepted yet, huh? Okay, but he's talking to LBS, and LBS told him, okay, if you apply with the GMAT, we need at least 650 and probably more on the last round. But if you take the GRE, since we don't publish our GRE statistics, you can take two with a lower score. And it's so that the guy has an outstanding profile, except he's not good at tests, he's probably rubbish in maths, but the rest is good. So they told him, take the GRE, you will not need our statistics, and we can take you with a low score. Like even they mentioned a 300, which is pretty low. Okay, basically, they would accept him with a low score, provided they take the GRE, because they don't publish their GRE statistics. Okay, so that's something that you have to consider. Alors, the other test that you can consider, because we have Indian students probably today, is the CAT. So the CAT is an Indian test that you have to take to go to ISB and IIM. And the CAT is accepted in some schools, where all the business schools in India take the CAT. But in France, for instance, ESSEC accepts the CAT. So you have, and of course, the CAT is super cheap because it's only $27. When you compare to the 350 of the GMAT, Nick, so it makes a big difference, okay? It's even... you can go down up to $13, okay? But of course, it's India. People have lower purchasing power, but it gives you an idea of how inexpensive it can be. Yeah, okay, so 1,900 Indian rupees. Yes, so these tests are still general tests in that they are used. Okay. So same thing, we have a test in France. We have the French GMAT, it's called the Tajmaj. And the Tajmaj is, of course, is accepted by all the French schools, okay? But it is also accepted by a lot of Canadian schools, so HEC Montreal, TEFLER, accept the Tajmaj. So, of course, if your prime is English, you say, I will take the Tajmaj and I can get HEC Montreal. Okay? So that's basically the 4 tests that are quite common. Okay? And some of the common tests can be accepted for schools outside India for the CAT, and some schools outside France for the Tajmaj. But, of course, what happened is what we have. Alors, then there's a new test that has appeared, and you're an expert at this, by the way. I wanted you to take care of one of my students, is Pierre. So there is the executive assessment test. So Nick, can you please tell us about the story with the executive assessment test? So what was it for, and what is it for now?
Well, the EA, we're going to call it, started about 5 years ago, and originally it was for executive MBAs, in other words, people with 10 years work experience. Traditionally, those type of programs accepted or required GMAT, but they accepted a lower score than the full-time programs. And that's out of consideration that the applicants have been out of school for 10, 15 years. So there was a big burden on them to relearn math and grammar. In the meantime, the original EA was supposed to be a shortened GMAT. So instead of 3 hours, it's an hour and a half. And it goes into a little bit less depth, so it doesn't cover quite as many elements as the real GMAT. I would say the level of difficulty is definitely a bit lower, and the prep time is faster. Hubert has given examples of how he used EA to apply to top schools.
Yeah. We've been using what happened last year, Nick? What happened last year?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what happened last year? So they decided to, so what happened? Some schools accepted to take the EA. That was the EA that was originally a score for EMBA applicants became a score accepted by six or seven business schools in the US. Yeah, mm-hmm. By six or seven programs. Yeah, is it? Have you used it as well as an alternative to the GMAT?
Yeah, but for EMBAs successfully, but I have not used it for a full-time program yet, Hubert, although yeah. Ever since you talked about that, it's a yeah. compelling idea, definitely.
So me, I have used it for Swiss students from our partner in Spain. Two from a partner in Spain and one from the partner in Peru. Mm-hmm. And these students, they had taken the test, scored something like between 550 and 600, which is, of course, not tough.
And no, that's took, doable. That's doable.
Yeah, but with 550 in Colombia, it's difficult. So, so basically, they decided to take the EA. So we prepared them for the EA, which is, of course, an easier test. And finally, one got Colombia, one got NYU, and the other one got Duke.
That's okay? Amazing.
So they got Duke using the EA. Now, why is it interesting? So basically, I'm going to tell you the way it works. The EA is scored between 0 and 160, okay? Mm-hmm. They have a scoring table, and they say, imagine that if you have 150, you're in the top 10%, you're in the top, 8% of the test, okay? So they say, oh, great, 150, you're in the top 8% of the test. Then they compare the 8% of the test of the EA to the 8% of the test in the GMAT, and they say, if you're in the 8% of the test on the GMAT, okay, you have a 720. Okay, so it means that I had students who got a 150 on DEA, which is not good.
No.
That was converted into a 720. Oh, okay, thank you. Getting 720 is difficult. And finally, we got accepted to Columbia. So my students who got accepted to Columbia, NYU, and Columbia, NYU, and Duke, their score was between 150 and 153. And they all converted into 700 plus scores, whereas when they took their GMAT, and they never mentioned that they took the GMAT, their score was not even 600.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's something that I can advise. But of course, few MBA programs accept the EA. So the programs that accept the EA are Chicago Booth, I mean, for the MBA, huh? Okay? Mm-hmm. Chicago Booth, Columbia, NYU, Duke, Cornell, voilà. And then an MIT, I've heard that they will accept it. Okay, and by the way, you have to know that some schools have decided to even skip the GMAT, okay, MIT,
yes, for instance. And Cornell.
Cornell, and so BU, for instance. BU, would you love at BU? But BU is a top 20 program in the US, okay?
No, obviously, so, that's in, we're watching yeah, that.
It's a good school, and some schools have decided to even skip the GMAT for all this year. Now, the students that I got accepted to MIT this year, they all had the GMAT between, that was a minimum of 740. I didn't have any student accepted to MIT without the GMAT. More information. So they said they don't need the GMAT, but getting into MIT without the GMAT, I wish that it works, but it didn't work this year. By the way, I didn't have any students applying without the GMAT, but I could have done it. But I'm
to MIT.
Yeah,
they didn't. I did. Didn't work. Perfect profile.
Didn't work.
No,
didn't work.
Profile. Yeah. Yeah. So, didn't work. So, I was surprised.
You have to say to the person. Yeah, if he or she has a perfect profile, say, look. Take your GMAT. Anand, hello, Anand. Have you joined us, Anand? So Anand from India.
Yeah.
Just joined us. So basically, Anand, so what is your experience with people taking the GMAT? Okay, so can you introduce yourself, Anand? And
hi.
What do you offer to those who fail the GMAT? You offer them that they stop, you offer them that they go for another test. So what is your experience of getting the GMAT? And in India,
can you hear me now?
Yeah. So is it difficult for Indian students to pass the GMAT? Provided
students, it won't be difficult that much because since childhood only we are taught in such a way that mathematics part and analytical reasoning part we are pretty good in that. Yeah. Because in many of the people in India study engineering and they are from mathematics background, so I don't think Indian people find it that much of difficult. Because it's basics mathematics, but you have to be very quick. Most of the calculation has to be done in mind itself rather than lifting your pen and doing it. So you have to be very quick because time is very less and you have multiple kind of questions where you have to think accordingly.
Yeah.
So basically, So it's a good thing. It's a good thing to know. But at the same time, we know that some Indian students are struggling. And in the case of a student is struggling, so what do you suggest him? So basically they will be take another test, take an alternative test, take the GMAT, take the GRE, or take an in-house test, or take a school without the GMAT, for instance. You see, for instance, Nick, there's a Warwick Business School doesn't ask for any test, okay? And Warwick Business School is a good school.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you cannot pass the GMAT, it means you're not an outstanding student. So if you get Warwick, you should be happy. It's a top 10 MBA, and it's a top 20 master in management in Europe. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Is it what you recommend? If they fail, yeah.
Yeah. They should practice as much as tests as possible so that they can score. The more they score, the better it is. The chances of getting the top 10 business school or top 20, which we are targeting, that if they are aiming for that, then they really need to practice a lot, and they can give the test series. There are various test series. Plus, I also design many of those tests, which are aligned with the GMAT pattern.
Of course, they are all taken. But by the way, well, we see that there is a new family of tests, okay, coming up. Mm-hmm. Which is slightly different, and probably the origin is not the GMAT. It's probably they are designed from recruitment tests. Okay, mm-hmm. And now they use recruitment tests as academic recruitment tests. You see, for instance, to give you an idea, the VBAT in Belgium is designed by a company called Hudson Learning, and Hudson design HR test, okay? SHL is a big psychometric center in the UK, and they design recruitment tests for big corporations, because there's probably a bigger business for corporations. Nick, I know that you teach a lot. I know that you teach the SHL, probably the IGAT. What is your familiarity with this test, Nick?
The issue that with these tests, if you know, it's all sort of GMAT based with this analytical logic reasoning. My issue with those tests is that there's no transparency, so you never know how you did, and I'm not even convinced that the test serves the purpose of measuring achievement. I wonder sometimes if the test is just a tool for admissions.
It's a tool for admission. So basically, you raise a good point. So basically, you never get your HBA, your VBAT, your IGAT score. You never get it, okay? And it's used in the process. But of course, I had students. They were not my students, because they came to see me after that, who told me that they had failed the test, okay? And they were going to prepare the GMAT. So I had a student, for instance, who applied for IE. He passed the IGAT on his own, failed, and then after that we had to prepare the GMAT so that he can get to IE, because the IGAT you can only take it once in your life.
Fair point. I just always wondered. I had that as well, Hubert, and then I couldn't help wondering if that was already, if that was the reason, if it was actually the test, or if there were other issues with the application. But if you
they would tell you. But you see, even the IGAT, even though it's not that difficult, you need to practice for it. So basically, I went to invite Anushka, because Anushka she had an issue with the GMAT. We're not going to tell her our GMAT score. So Anushka,
yes, sir.
And by the way, she helped me make the presentation, because since she knows about all these tests, we have work on the presentation ourselves. And she made the some of the slides, because she's super knowledgeable in all these tests. So basically, you came for the GMAT. You didn't do as well as you wanted. It's not that you couldn't get a good GMAT, but you say that you have your studies, you have your application, and you cannot spend your time working on the GMAT. You see, Anand, it's of course you have to encourage people to get a good score. But at some stage, if they have a job, if they have their schools, if they have family issues, maybe there's a day where you have to say stop. I should find an alternative. Can you tell us about your story, Anushka?
Actually, when I was preparing for GMAT, I was in my fifth semester. I am still in my final year of Delhi University. So it was really difficult for me, because I was also preparing for CAT. I was preparing for GMAT and my language classes were also going on. And I took two attempts, but I couldn't score the target score. I wanted a score of 650, but I couldn't do it. So like Hubert sir suggested me that we can take a lot of in-house tests, and that can get us to top top business schools, top 21 MIMs, because I wanted to do a master's in management since I don't have a work ex and I'm still in my final year. So I took all these tests, and I took the VBAT, I took the HIT test, I took the IEAT, I took the essential skills test that was for ESMT Berlin. And fortunately, I got admission into all of them. And like, I still am waiting for my final interview for IEGAT. So like, my experience was like IEGAT, the procedure was a little bit tedious. First, they took it, and IEGAT had 6 levels actually. So it was of it took me 2.5 hours. And there were some new sections also, like you have to write a mail, sort out a mail, and you have to send it to different people and sort out into different sections. So they were like different sections, like unlike the analytical and abstract test, which is common for different schools, IEGAT was a little bit different. So, and after that, I gave a Kira interview, and the Kira interview was also like, there were 2 questions which were live. And one was a written, and like for the Kira interview, I prepared along with Hubert sir. He helped me, like giving me all type of questions. Like first of all, the questions about the school, then questions about myself, then questions related to culture and diversity, because they can ask you anything. And they even asked me like what innovation did, like the first question that they asked me in the Kira interview was that what innovation has changed the history of business? So, and the other question was that...
What did you say? The internet?
Yeah. I'm sorry?
Yeah, you're going to say?
The washing machine, the internet?
But you have to find something else, huh? Because that's...
I know, that's what I'm just curious. Yeah. It's we're just training for Kira, so I'm curious what people are approaching that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they want something different, yes.
I know.
So the situation that we have...
Because she's successful, so I'm just for your perfect chance to get...
And the problem that you have, so you have issues with this test, is that you don't really know what to expect. You see,
exactly.
That's why we say to the people: if you prepare the GMAT, you're going to buy material, whatever type of material. Anyway, the publisher published material, test prep centers many publish good things. People like me, Kartipe, or Anand are super knowledgeable, so there will be no surprise. But for instance, of course, when you prepare the IGAT, so I've prepared myself a class. Okay, so I have an IGAT class. That I prepared after having prepared Anushka, because I found out that the one that I had was pretty weak. So I prepared a good math review. Then now I prepared lessons, so lesson on data interpretation, on the diagrammatic reasoning, and on inductive reasoning. And then you found out before taking the test that now there's also an email that you have to send to colleagues, and it's nowhere. So even when you go in the official website of IE, it's not even mentioned. So you have to go through students that will tell you, no, it was not exactly, it's not exactly what they say on the website.
Exactly. Okay? Right.
So on their website, they tell you 3 sections, and finally you find out that there's something else that appears in the middle of the blue, like this. Huh? You see, Nick? So the problem that you have with this test, so basically Anushka, she took the VBAT. So the VBAT, you agree, and it's funny because when you go on the VBAT website, you see, they tell you that you have abstract reasoning and analytical reasoning. And in reality, it is data interpretation. You agree? The VBAT is just data interpretation. But can you imagine, Nick, when you go on their website, they tell you something that is not even true. Remember the first time I had to prepare a student for the VBAT 7 years ago? I went on their website. I said, okay, abstract reasoning. What does it look like? So, okay, I'm going to design exercise, ethical reasoning. So I said, okay. And then I found out that it was not that at all. So the student told me, and I said, okay, look, okay. But that's why you need to work with people when you go for alternative tests. We have expertise in this field. Okay? And remember, with ASMT, they gave us a book. So I never had anybody taking the ASMT test. Remember, Anushka?
Yes,
they gave us a book to prepare. And they said, okay, prepare with this book. And then when she took the test, it was completely different.
Completely different.
So how can I know? How can I know what each school... So at the end, so you have to see, when you go into this test, you have to see that you may be surprised, because there is no standards. Okay, they can change the test at the last minute. For instance, or cancel, for instance, ERTS, they had their own test called GHBA, and they have decided to, they don't use it anymore, okay? Now they use a test called FSET, okay? And so at the end, it's very difficult for us to follow. So of course I follow because I'm interested in tests, but yeah, sometimes it's very difficult. So give you another example. So at DIGAT, we tend to understand what it is. PBAT, because yeah, TeamViso, yeah, okay, we have it, okay? So we see SHL, and as you know, Nick, in SHL, in reality, you have 20 different sections, and ESCP, because this test is given by ESCP, they choose four sections out of the 20 sections of SHL, and every year it changed. It's a nightmare, okay? So there's, of course, there's always inductive reasoning, which is like critical reasoning and data interpretation, okay? And yep, then they are going to take a different section of the thing. So it's very difficult. And of course, we cannot produce any material because we don't have enough students taking them. So we can, yeah, can only follow, arrange a class to make sure. So the test on which, for instance, Attendee Center will develop expertise are VBAT, IGAT, and SHL. Of course, TeamViso and HBA, there's not enough demand for that. What do you do, Unique, when you have someone, because I'm sure that you have ESCP business school applicants, how do you prepare your student for the SHL? What do you do? What would you recommend yourself?
Yeah, you know, Hubert, the truth is it depends a little on the individual. So if we have a math or verbal strength, and we just look at our database of what happened in other years, but we just go for the quick wins. We even have GMAT questions that we think approximate to the questions on the test. I have a database of psychometric tests, some of the image recognition things. So, yeah, it's a challenge, to be honest. But, I mean, we know the tests, and we talk to people in the school and get as much information, and then we can piece together a good approximation.
On the experience.
It's always a little guessing, as you said. Is it a little guessing? On the other hand, we know it's a logic reasoning test, so any training will help.
Yes, of course. But what we did with Anushka, we prepared every test. I mean, Anushka. So there was a new test every 2 weeks. So that's what we did every 2 weeks. So it was a nightmare for her because she had to prepare VBAT, IGAT, SHL, and the Frankfurt test as well. So that's the most common alternative test. And then there are others that are other in-house that are, of course, less common. So ESAD has his own test, Amdot Management School has his own test, ESMT in Berlin has his own test, Frankfurt, for which you teach, has his own test as well. I've never prepared for this test because usually the student I have for ESAD, they take the GMAT. Antwerp, I don't have any student. Frankfurt School, the last one that I got accepted, they're applying the GMAT. So basically, what you have to see is that if you don't have a good GMAT score, it means that you're going to have to prepare test school per school. And plus, you're going to there's no material available. So now what Nick said with reasons, we don't know if they use this test to assess people or to just say that we have a test. Obviously, some schools, I don't want to mention them, they say that they have a test, but it is just for the sake of having a test. You agree, Nick?
There's no transparency, and that's certainly how it looks, though. I mean, that's definitely how it looks.
And they are, some of these tests, they are all much cheaper than the GMAT, but they're not that cheap. For instance, for essential management tests, it's already $129, okay?
Yeah.
Which is expensive for a test for which you have no preparation, no material available. At least the GMAT, they give you material, okay? So what is important is that the test, so there are good news and bad news. So it means that some schools are ready to cancel the GMAT and use their test. So it's a good news, but the bad news is that anyway, there will be always a test. But of course, the test that they're using tends to look more like a nature management test, like a niche that the growth management test. Okay. For instance, sometimes it happens that I help students pass the test for recruitment. Okay, they show me how it works, so we do it together. We cheat. Okay, let's put it that way. And the test that they have to get into, I don't know, Heineken or some consulting companies look really like the VBAT or the IGAT. So basically, it was modeled after that. And companies offering HR tests have decided to get into a new market, which is the market of of business school admission. Okay. Yes. So tell me, Anand, what would you say? Because in India, you have a lot of tests, because you have the Indian test, like the CAT. They also use the American test. So what is the situation in terms of tests in India? How does it work? What tests do people take?
So we have many tests. For MBA in Indian school, we have a CAT exam, one of the most toughest exam in India, where you have to really score quite pretty high, like in the range of 99.8 percentile to 99.9 to get the top colleges ABC. So in that case, your quant comes into very pictures. Quant, you have to be really smart, really. I mean, the practice should be in such a way so that you can solve the problem within second, like 15 to 20 seconds you have to solve. And you cannot, in that case, lift pen and you can think of trying the problem solving in the general way. No, it's not going to work out. You have to be super fast, extraordinary alert. The moment you see the question, it has to click within a second. Either you know it, either you skip it. That's how it works. Otherwise, you'll be out of the race. You won't be getting the top colleges, which we are targeting ABC.
Yeah. And that's why so many students apply at the same time abroad, because they don't get the score that they want for the CAT. And they say that even with a lower score, even with a 700 on the GMAT, you get a good school. We gave a seminar with ISEC like 1 month ago, and that's what we explained. The reason why you have so many Indians studying abroad is that because it is easier financially to study abroad. Okay. The market, you see, and the market is made in such a way so that it arranges the US and Europe, who claim that they are the best. It's very funny the way it works, the way they have oriented the market, the way they have developed the communication, etc. And I can see the same thing. You see, we are launching a ranking, okay? And now we have many schools who are unhappy because we have ranked LSC as a master in management and Sciences Po Paris, okay? And some schools refuse to give us interviews because we have put these two schools that were not in the rankings. You see, and LSE and Sciences Po Paris are great schools.
Right.
Yeah. Nick, are you with us?
Yeah, I am. I have the same experience.
No, but we have decided to put Sciences Po Paris and LSE in our ranking, and they were not ranked. And of course, they are not ranked because they are somehow public universities. Okay, and the private universities, they don't want.
Did you see the news on the rankings that came out like a few weeks ago that there's huge problems this year? There's a big discrepancy, and that the only one you should look at is U.S. News, is what the thing said.
Why? Mm-hmm. Because there's no because U.S. schools have refused to be in the rankings.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I actually wrote a blog about that, and because I studied the thing. So the
rankings. Yeah, that's why we decided to publish our ranking. That's why.
And actually, Hubert, it just shows you they need a neutral ranking like you. It shows you there's a niche in the market for a better
ranking. Yeah, of course, there's a need for a ranking.
Yeah.
And what I wanted to say is that. So yes, you have to see the way they develop. And you see, the way I developed this ranking is because one day there was an institute called Institut Choiseul, which is backed by the biggest newspaper in France called Le Figaro. They do a sales job, and they took the top 100 most promising managers in France. Okay, and these managers are between, I would say, 30 to 40 years old. And after 40 years old, you no longer pass. Okay, and these guys, they all have top jobs. Okay, and what was funny is that out of the 100, Nick, how many was from INSEAD? How many, Nick? One. Out of the 100 most promising, one.
Yeah, you know.
How many from HEC?
From Polytechnic.
One. Yeah. One. Okay. One from INSEAD. One from INSEAD. One from HEC. Like five from Polytechnic, of course. Only. I agree with you. And strangely enough, like five from ESSEC, and the most represented was Sciences Po, Paris. And it's funny, and at the same time, you said, because I'm a Sciences Po Paris graduate at the same time, so I went to Sciences Po, and I always thought, because of the ranking, that we are a bad school. By the way, it's not true, because in DFT, in the QS ranking, Sciences Po is ranked number 2 in the world, a social science school, just after Harvard. And it's true, by the way, it's a very good school. You have to take a contest. At my time, you have to take a difficult contest. It was not just taking the GMAT, you have to take a contest with, it was something serious. And then I thought to myself, so why is the school, why are they doing so well? So probably because technically they are not as strong as the guy from HEC, but they write much better. they're much better educated because they know so about history, not just about business. They have a social science background. And we have the feeling that if you have that, it helps a lot as well in life. Okay, not just to have technical knowledge in business. So when I saw that, I said that we should rank Sciences Po and let's have the statistics on Sciences Po. And then you see that they rank in the top 10 in Europe. And by the way, it's normal because honestly, it's ESCP is number 6, Sciences Po is much better. Okay. But and same thing for LSE. LSE is an outstanding school, you see, Mick. But of course, it's with they I don't know why they don't rank. Okay, so we have decided to rank Sciences Po and LSE. And of course, when you rank them, you see from the results that it's a top 10, of course. Okay. Yeah. And plus, the advantage of these schools like LSE and Sciences Po is that HEC, they only send people into business, whereas Sciences Po, they would send, or LSE, into government, into international institutions, into the arts, into. And I find that it's better because today, where will success come from? Where will success come from? Yes, you can be successful because you're a choreographist or because you know, there are many, many ways of succeeding in life and in business and even with a different type of background. For instance, you know that people who are in media, they have very good jobs, they are very powerful, but at HEC or INSEAD, nobody works in the media. At Sciences Po, they have a media section. And all the journalists that you see on TV, they come from Sciences Po. So at the end, you have to say, look, what are we assessing? So they have designed their ranking that ranks them well, okay? And of course, this set of ranking is going to change things because we say, look, what you say is completely stupid. So it's completely biased.
But you raise a valid point that many people come to me with just the FT rankings, the first five, and they say, let's apply there. Uh-huh. And then I ask them, well, what do you think about the school? What attracts you to the program? They don't know. They've never looked at it.
Yeah, because they know that people will have a look. Day. Yeah, and companies will have a look at them. And they are right, by the way. But fortunately, for instance, in France, we have also a great school called Dauphine. Mm-hmm. It's a great university. And it's funny when I see I had like 3 students from Dauphine accepted. Two got LBS and one got INSEAD. Okay. And Dauphine is a very difficult school to university to get in, but it's a public university. So of course, since it's free, it's very selective, but of course they don't communicate. They don't, I do my postdoctorate at Dauphine. I can tell you, I have two guys with two out of my teachers, two got the Field Medal. You know what is the Field Medal? It's the Nobel Prize in Mathematics, okay? I have two guys who got the Field Medal. Two of my colleagues, okay, are Field Medals. So two of my colleagues have a Nobel Prize in Mathematics. If you want to go in America, they will say, whoa, you have to pay $1 million, you know, because you have a guy who has a Nobel Prize in Mathematics. There, the program costs nothing. I pay my Social Security, I don't know why, €850 per year. That's me or some administrative fee that I have to pay for the access to the library, whatever. I pay $850 per year. And my colleagues are Nobel Prize. You see? You understand? Okay. And when I ask my students from Dauphine, say, okay, you come from a crappy public university in France, must be difficult. They say, look, Hubert, inside, it's a joke. Okay, LBS, it's a joke. Okay. Mm-hmm. I partied all the time. I never studied. I was in the top 1% of my class. McKinsey saw that I was in the top 1%, and they gave me a scholarship. They all have a coach. So when you're a top student at LBS or INSEAD, they pay for a coach to prepare the interviews. I was not aware of that. So they have received a scholarship to be trained by a McKinsey consultant who is going to train them. Yeah. So that they make sure that these guys, say they're in the top 1%. Okay, they told me I've never opened a book. Okay, in 1 year, and the top 1%, they told me it's a joke, okay, LBS, it's a pure joke, okay? They told me I partied all the time, etc.
So it depends on your goals. If they want to get jobs, maybe it wasn't
a job. But they're in the top 1%, Nick. Yeah, they're not like in the last, they're in the top 1%, okay? Mm-hmm. So because what they've done at Dauphine was so much more difficult, but the school is not ranked. So I could not get data of Dauphine. That's why I could not rank Dauphine. And I don't think that Dauphine is that strong in terms of graduate program. But for bachelor, it's very good. So basically, what I want to say is that yes, you have to be careful. Now, of course, usually the schools that we have here are not the... So what is important is that they are top schools. Of course, Vlerick is the best business school in Belgium. Mm. But bon, AI, questionable. Huh? VAU is the best business school in Germany. Okay. ESCP is a good school, okay? But EZAD is a good school. Antwerp, well, not so much. Frankfurt School is a good school. And now we have very good students applying to Frankfurt School. SMT, not bad. So yeah, what I tend to see is that they don't play the game, but they want to have the test. Okay. So so what I would say is that, and we'll ask Anushka to conclude. What can I say? So I could say that basically, if you're good at the GMAT, great. And of course, it's a good news. If you're not that good, there are lots of opportunities. Nick, you agree?
That's
there are
definitely lots of 100% opportunities. True. Yeah, okay. There's never one way to do something.
Never one way. True. It's true that, for instance, me, I come from France, which is an elitist country in terms of studies, where if you fail, your life is over. Mm. I remember when I was in America, when I had friends wanted to become physician, but they have all become physicians. Okay, they didn't go to Harvard or to Stanford or to Columbia. They have gone to second year school, but they have been able to graduate as physicians. You see that in many countries in Europe, if you're not a top student, you cannot even get into the university. And after 1 year, they kicked out 95% of the students. So it's difficult, okay? But in the US, if you're already, there's a way, which is I find is good, okay? I prefer this system to the European system. Okay, mm-hmm. don't take me wrong, because I find that you have that you're given a chance. Okay, you'll not be a Stanford physician, but you know you'll be a Madison, whatever, and you're sure Madison, and still fine. You still can cure people. You agree?
Definitely, yeah.
And if it's your patient, and you become good at it, okay. The greatest physician in France is called Professor Raoult. One day I met him like 3 years ago, mm-hmm. and he told me. That he could not solve an equation. Okay? He cannot solve an equation. He's the biggest epidemiologist in the world. It's called Professor Didier Raoult. He's the greatest epidemiologist in the world. He told me, I cannot solve an equation. I'm bad at math. But the guy is the biggest epidemiologist in the world. He has published 2,500 articles, and if he takes care of you, you never die. So it means that, okay, yeah. And I had an uncle who was a cardiologist, same thing, who told me that he could not ever solve a math equation, and he has become a professor of medicine and cardiologist because he was good at medicine, but not good at math. Okay, and he told me, what is math for when you're a physician? Okay, I've never used in math. I have a good memory. I know how to diagnose a patient. I know how to talk to them. I understand medicine. I understand human body. But don't ask me to solve a quadratic equation, I don't know what it is.
That's it.
You see? Yeah, that's the way it is. So, of course, ultimately, the thing is, where do we use tests? Okay. where do we use tests? Yeah, we use tests because it's part, in reality, tests is part of the marketing. No, what do you think? Okay. Imagine that you apply to Vléric and there's no test. I don't know if you will apply to Vléric. Doesn't look serious. So, they cannot take the GMAT because. Okay, their students cannot pass the GMAT, but if they have no test, people will not take them seriously. Anushka, do you think I'm right when I say something like that? No?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is that you never apply to a school that has no test? Okay, it doesn't look serious.
Yeah.
Okay. You agree, Nick? It's a good conclusion.
Definitely, yeah. Of course, it's true.
Yes, that's because there's a tradition. Yeah. There's a tradition of
understanding tests. Perception driven, fully agree.
Okay, so it was nice to talk to you. So, Anand, you didn't have time to introduce yourself. So, can you introduce yourself, Anand, since you arrived late? Anand, you want to introduce yourself?
Whoa, 1 second. Yeah, sure. I went for a run. Unfortunately, situation in India is not good right now due to COVID-19. There's a complete lockdown, so we are not supposed to go out.
But
so, I've been
out.
Into this. I went out because I went for running. I run very often. Nearby to my locality only I went. Yeah, okay. So from past 6+ years, I'm into teaching. I have my own academy, Anand Learning Academy, where I've been training people for GMAT, GRE, TOEFL, all the in India also and abroad also. I teach people most. Right from grade 6, I mentor people till all competitive examination, which we see day in and day out. Straight GRE, be it GRE. GRE myself I have given, TOEFL myself I have given. GMAT I have not given so far. Because I wanted to do my research in masters and all. So GRE, TOEFL, then CAT exam I have given. So all those Indian exams and international exam, first I gave myself so that I can equip myself with all the tools and techniques which any student needs. so that I can train them accordingly for that particular exam. So it's been now quite. So far 6 years been into this, and it's going pretty good.
And you, because they did not introduce you fully, Nick. So a bit more about yourself, Nick. Introduce yourself, but maybe you want to introduce yourself and talk to students.
Sure, of course.
So I did my engineering way back in 2014. So I have a couple of years experience as a software engineer development. So I have worked for many companies, big giants, Infosys, Manhattan Associates. So 4 or 5 years I worked on. Then side by side, I thought of let's try to motivate people and let's try to train them for various competitive examinations. Right, because there are multiple platforms these days and students get really confused which one to focus for, say any particular exam like GMAT or GRE they want to focus on. So there are many channels on YouTube also and various other platforms. So they don't know where to go, first of all, which teachers to choose, what all those topics to master it so that they can target the top colleges accordingly. So that's where I thought of running my own company called Anand Learning Academy, where I have been mentoring people from past 5 to 6 years. It's now 6+ years close to that. So
in India, And Unique, so Unique basically, your model is to teach directly at universities, and you teach for 3 universities. That's mainly what you do. Unique, and you teach mainly at Frankfurt School, LMU, that's your job.
Well, I mean, we have a B2B model, and to be honest, a lot of the arrangements were offered by the university that I sent them through my GMAT Zurich company, successful students, and they thought, wait a minute, why don't we just work directly? So these came usually on the basis of success. So people were happy. They asked the students who went to the school, how did you know, what was the story? They said, oh, I met this incredibly helpful company, and they really changed my life. And this school reached out and said, wait a minute, why don't we do something then? And that's basically how it happened.
So as a conclusion, but thank you for coming. So what I would say is that the admission process in a top business school is standardized. Now there are exceptions. You can do it differently. Of course, not all schools accept alternatives to the GMAT, but there are already alternatives to the GMAT in that there are tests that are accepted anywhere, such as the GRE. So it's already a good alternative to the GMAT. And there are also many other tests available. And of course, the problem that we have with this test is that we don't know your score, the material is not available, and sometimes you can have surprise, like the IGAT, they give you the material, and then you find out that they had the section the day before. Well, that's the way it is, and we will move from there. Okay, thank you very much, guys.
Thank you, Hubert, for organizing. Very interesting to talk.
Okay, thank you very much. Have a good day. Anyway, it will be on our YouTube channel. We have recorded the event. Thank you very much, Nick, for being with us. Bye-bye.
Thank you.